ladies and gentlemen, Miss Joan Rivers.
First of all, I am so thrilled to be here. I just want you to know that. Want to see he still does tricks, by the way. Stay.
It was interesting working with people you knew of. I'd seen Joan Rivers doing a show, and that was the limit of my knowledge. And then I was going to be working with her. Neil Shannon and I were hired to write for her.
If they had had Twitter in the old days, it's Joan of Arc. Is it just me, or do you smell smoke too? It would have been...
Yesterday, I said to my husband, Edgar, I said, women are like wine. The older we get, the mellower we become. He locked me in the cellar. I mean, it's just...
Still a male-dominated comedy world. And Joan Rivers, with a no-fear approach, don't heckle her. No subject was taboo, she went for it. And she did actually say to me, I've got to be on the attack. I'm a woman, get noticed in this male world.
I found this dress on the chair next to my husband's bed. Isn't that lucky? Oh, don't stop with me.
Her beginnings, she was much gentler. I mean, she was still punchy.
Well, she was on with Johnny Carson, yeah. Wasn't she?
Johnny Carson gives her her big break.
Yes. She was then a regular on his show.
I think he had her on once. She was so good, he sat her down and said, you're going to be a big star, which he didn't say to people. He wasn't somebody that banded at her.
No, he wasn't his style at all.
Everyone tells you your baby is going to be gorgeous when it's first born. A baby when it's first born is a mess. I'm sorry to tell you this.
A little grim.
A little grim. Wet head. You know, the nurse says, it looks just like you. I mean, you're in labor 108 days and that's your first compliment. Look, it's just, I hit it with the kid. Mind your damn.
There's a big tradition in America of stand-ups on the what they call the talk shows, which is a tradition we've never really had here.
The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson was an iconic career-making show. It was, if you like, the replacement to Ed Sullivan. It was the place where you went and you could make your name with a good 15 minutes of conversation with Carson. Carson really devised the format that we now probably think of quite often as American chat shows. Joan Rivers came on to the show. Initially, she was hired as a gag writer for Carson, and then he spotted her talent. So he got her on screen for one appearance, and then she did so well that he brought her back and back and back. And in the end, she was the official replacement and co-host. I mean, she fully hosted 80-odd Johnny Carson shows when he was on holiday.
I mean, the love has dropped off in your marriage? I mean...
No, it hasn't dropped
off. You know, nothing can be like the honeymoon forever when you people, you know, get married. You know, youngsters always think how great to get married. Wow, be together, you know...
Huggy-kissy?
Yeah, it has to taper off a little bit.
Yeah, but how much can it taper? I mean, you know, he said to me the other day, I said, I'm not looking so good, I need a little beauty sleep. He said you'd have to go into a coma. I mean,
The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson was America's most famous chat show. Johnny Carson was the king of the chat show hosts. They got on terribly well. They obviously had a chemistry. Carson himself was quite straight, but he wasn't off color. Joan Rivers was way off color. I mean, she was even then sort of quite prepared to say things that everybody was thinking but didn't dare say in public. She didn't say it in public, she said it on television. She said it on the most famous chat show in America.
Why are you always so concerned about looks all the time? I mean, what?
Because a woman has to have good looks, unless she's very rich. If you're rich, it doesn't matter. Christina Onassis, who's a dear friend of mine.
Yes.
Is she here?
Close, is she?
That's a... Look for a woman eating Cycle 3. Very well, here we go. Is she pretty? Oh, grow up, America. I am so bored with her.
She's not.
I think she came alive. I think it did suit her to be in a talk show studio or to be in some location where she could interact a bit and be either be pushed or restrained, I've had to fight back.
So she was central to the show for years, but also it was central to her career. And she would say that it was Johnny Carson who discovered her, really.
Please. He wants a hot meal. Well, I'm married 14 years, it's all over. You know,
what do you mean it's all over now?
Well, in the beginning, he's to cook and clean and carry on. Now, 14 years, he wants a hot meal? Let him sleep with Julia Child. There is nothing. That's it. I serve ketchup for a vegetable. There is nothing at all. Birth control, I imagine we all use the same thing. You know what's very big now, birth control-wise, in the States, is the sponge. Do you have that here yet? The sponge. No. It's terrific. It's a little hard to swallow, but it is well...
She knew no fear, no subject was taboo to her. She'd talk about anything and everything. She'd go into areas no other comedians would go.
The only good thing about living with a handicapped person, the bathrooms are fabulous. Have you ever been in a handicapped bathroom? All those railings, oh, I lock the door, I do Pilates, it is great.
Joan Rivers was a trailblazer because she would get up on the stages, the comedy club stages, which were harsh environments, and tell jokes on bills in which there would be mostly men. So her comedy had to face up to the comedy of the act before and the act after. And what she did was she took topics, instead of trying to play to the audience and say, you know, tell them topics they might want to talk about, she talked about herself and she talked about the truth as she saw it, and she talked about her experiences and her politics, but with a funny twist. She was one of the first true, unfiltered women comedians.
When I was 21, my mother said, only a doctor for you. When I was 22, she said, all right, a lawyer, CPA. 24, she said, well, grab a dentist. 26, she said, anything. If he could make it to the door, he was mine, you know? What do you mean you don't like him? He's intelligent, he found the bell himself. What do you want?
She was very good at talking about things that we all knew, all experienced, or all could see in front of us, like herself, and tell us the truth, but push the truth to the point where I suppose the ideal Joan Rivers laugh would be a because there's that she takes it, all your friends in the pub will be making jokes about it, but she's the one who has the top joke. She's the one who crushes it.
She was prepared to be as rude and as outrageous as possible on virtually any subject. She'd like to be outrageous. She would do jokes about, you know, after 9/11, she would do jokes about 9/11 and everyone else fearing to tread.
7/7, I had such respect. We're still looking. We know the guy's name. It's been 4 years. Osama bin Laden, we know what he looks like. It's a tall man in a sheet. How hard is that? Just stand in front of linen sales. Just stand. That, and he's in Iraq on a dialysis machine. They have one outlet. Have you ever been to Iraq? There's one outlet. Follow the plug. Go with the cord. We gotcha. How'd you find me?
I think she didn't mind doing a joke that was risque that bombed. I think she wanted to do it, wanted to push it, didn't she? I think
yes.
She'd sort of say, you know, comedy should be about making people laugh, but also pushing the boundaries a bit. I mean, yeah, Auschwitz is not normally an area you go
exactly.
to for comedy.
I lost my entire family at Auschwitz, okay? They were in the other bus and it broke down, they never showed up. It was just... I was standing in the gift shop for hours.
So politically incorrect. She was not interested in political correctness.
No, it never occurred to her.
No. But it was quite scattergun. It wasn't like one area she just...
No, and broke every taboo.
Yeah.
Well, she didn't think of taboos. It didn't occur to her.
What was she like if people paid compliments to her?
People paid compliments, she lashed back at them. She wouldn't have a compliment.
Right.
When they sort of gushed at her, oh, Joan, you're so... Oh, boy, she went for them.
Right.
She liked to do the reverse of what had been expected in any situation.
They march. They're tall, they're thin, they're blonde, they're in leather. They don't look right, they don't look left. They march up the avenue. Oh, my God. leather and blonde hair, I am Jewish. You give me a guy, leather and blonde hair, I forgive them. Oh! Anne Frank would have said, I'm in the attic. Yes! I work clubs. You pass the hat wouldn't come back. I mean, I work mafia clubs where you pass the hat and the head would come back.
I think Joan Rivers' style, partly it always felt to me, is a kind of New York thing. It is quite an acerbic city where you have to cut through to be heard. But it's also, I think, it comes from coming up through nightclubs rather than through vaudeville. And it does make you harder edged. I suspect she discovered quite early on that if your comeback lines are as strong as the rest of your act, you know, if you're really good at staying on top of an audience, it's not just good for you, it's good for the audience.
Did you see on the Piers Morgan show when he had on Kirk Douglas and Dick Clark at the same time and they got into a fight? It was genius. I T-voted it. Every time I'm blue, I just watch it over and over and over. And the signer was Michael J. Fox. It was just... Oh, don't start with me. He is my very good friend. He got Parkinson's at 39, and they're all saying, People magazine, never happier. Oh, yeah, the man is thrilled.
I've seen clips of her where she does a risque joke or even a bad taste joke and someone heckles her. She just turns on the
audience. Oh, yes, fiercely.
You know, just says, well, what's your problem? You know, what, get over it. You know, grow up.
Oh, grow up. I hate the obituaries when they say things like Sadie Schwartz, 106, suddenly, and you go, hold it. 106, about time.
Joan Rivers' stand-up was quite satirical, but it was also quite self-mocking. So one of the early routines she did was, hey, when a woman is 30, she's not married, she's an old maid.
A man, he's 90 years old, he's not married, he's a catch. It's a whole different thing.
She'd riff on the kind of the sexual politics of it, and then she'd talk about her own perceived unattractiveness. So she was political but personal.
My darling, please, even coming over here this time, customs wanted to keep my thighs. I mean, as a child, I weighed what I weigh now when I was born. I was the fattest, I was a very fat, the school class picture, I am the front row. I was just looking through.
I interviewed her on a couple of occasions, so that's quite a good way of understanding how somebody works. You couldn't help admiring her, you know, chutzpah is the right word, or her bravery and her determination. Say, that is the area that people don't want anyone to talk about. I'll do a joke about it. And she can do it about herself.
I mean, do you ever worry about, you know, you pull the stuff about sort of fatness and looks and everything?
Like, ugliest child ever born in Larch Park, New York.
You? No.
Doctor looked at me, looked at the afterbirth, kept the afterbirth. Yes.
No.
Yes.
But do you worry
that your parents hated me. They would say, why can't you be like a cousin Charlotte? Why can't you be like a cousin Charlotte? Charlotte had died at birth.
As Joan Rivers got older, she dealt with aging by changing her. She went for all of the plastic surgery. She had facelift after facelift, and she would joke about it. So if someone mentioned something about it, she said, don't say that to my current face.
She was quite, I suppose, cruel in a way about other people's plastic surgery, but she'd also be, you know, hard on herself, saying, oh, yes, I've had to do this and I've had to do that.
The members of your family, when they say, I mean, how do they react?
They don't recognize me, so that's good, because every time it's like a first, you know. My grandson has never, ever seen me without a bandage somewhere. My daughter said they were watching Return of the Mummy the other night. He ran up to the TV and went, Grandma, Grandma!
Joan Rivers knew the Reagans. Prince Charles was a fan. and they seemed to enjoy her fearless approach, as if they had a sneaking regard for somebody who had no respect. She was a court jester.
Nancy, I shouldn't do jokes, because like your royal family, like they're elegant. They keep them that way. Nancy Reagan, of all our first ladies, I think has been the most elegant of any. You look at Nancy Reagan, and I'm not kidding you. You just know she's a lady. You know, mean, not mean, and she's, you know, a little bitchy. We'll talk about that later. Oh, please. She told Helen Keller, you shut up, I'm still talking. But
I think it's curious to find that Joan Rivers became a confidant and a friend of people like Ronald Reagan and Prince Charles, which didn't sit in a way well with the way that she portrayed her comedy. She said that she always had to, the satirist always had to be an outsider. So to then become very close with figures of power was slightly out of character.
She got on with Nancy Reagan, but you can kind of see that there was a sort of similarity in terms of their size and their look to them, and for all I know, Nancy was very funny and waspish and behind the scenes.
Nancy Reagan is a lady. You look at Nancy Reagan and you know when she washes out her pantyhose, she washes out the whole pantyhose, not just the feet and the crotch like the rest of the... This week's hot ticket was the Black Swan premiere in New York City.
Natalie Portman in this dress by Christian Dior.
Ooh. Nice. What I didn't like is that she's carrying a book. You know what I mean? You know what that says? It says, this movie sucks. I'm so bored. I'm going to read through it. And I know it's a purse, but wrong. It sends the wrong message.
The Fashion Police was a television show which was designed to discuss the way women dressed on the red carpet. And it went from praising to, things that didn't go quite right to absolute horror shows. And it was hugely entertaining. It was exactly the sort of thing for her comedy at that stage because it meant it was observational. She could still be bitchy if necessary. But at the same time, she could also be supportive if she actually liked something. But because of her position by that stage, people really paid attention to what she said.
How about Mila Kunis at the same premiere in this dress by Ellie Saab?
Gorgeous, gorgeous! And look, she's a movie star. Her big break was on That 70s Show. Mm-hmm. And she is standing there and she is thinking, I'm going to have a movie career come hell or high water. I will never work with Vilma Valderrama or whatever his stupid name is ever again.
Vilma
Valderrama. She doesn't care. She's finished with it.
It was so, A, true, but B, well-delivered, that even though she was being outrageously insulting to people, they would still come on the show. So she, at one point, she said that Justin Bieber had to stop dressing like he was a 6'2" black guy. And then shortly after that, he was on the show being funny and enjoying it. So she had a sort of a magic about her that allowed her to be outrageous but loved.
I think comedy does work well, that's my personal opinion, if you've got a mixture of something you're aiming towards which isn't comedy. Now, that can be discussing fashion on The Fashion Police for her, or it could be, you know, playing the violin or doing a song or doing a magic trick. It serves the comedy to have something other than comedy as your ostensible aim.
Emma came up to me because we're best friends, and she said, be honest, does this dress make me look? I said, yes. No matter what you were gonna ask me, yes, it makes you look fat, it makes you look dumpy, it makes you look hippie, and it makes you look stupid. The answer is yes. I don't know. Miley looks like she borrowed the dress from Angelina Jolie and the hair from David Spade. It just doesn't... England to me is just the best, okay? There are only two things that I really hate about America when I look at England. One is we don't have any national monuments like you do. Our oldest national monument is Joan Collins. And we talk about that one later. And the other thing is the year 1776 upsets me. One, because we broke with you in that year, and two, because it's Elizabeth Taylor's dress size. Please!
Joan Rivers was almost as popular in the UK as she was in the United States. When she came over, she found that she had a ready-made audience and a really quite important audience. Prince Charles, for example, was a huge fan, which gave her that kind of royal imprimatur.
This woman is so fast that she put on a red dress 30 school kids try to board her. She and Burton are known as Hamlet and Piglet. But, so I just thought I'd come out here and we could talk a little bit and you could ask me some things and I could answer some questions and see what happens. Remember, we helped you during the war. So.
My first recollection of Joan Rivers is the big ITV audience widths that they used to do. And she came over and the audience is packed full of UK stars, Jimmy Tarbuck, Bruce Forsyth. The list went on and on. Every time it panned to the audience, you'd go, well, there they are, newsreaders, all everyone. And she loved it. And she's roasting everyone, you know, just sort of having a real go at very rude about Elizabeth Taylor, very politically incorrect, calling her fat, people shocked. And it was like this sort of American bombshell hit the UK. She obviously famous already, but for me, it was the first time I'd seen anything like that.
Yes, anybody else want to know anything? Oh, thank God. I don't know. Fight among yourselves. Yes.
Would you consider doing a talk show over here?
I would, and I know you're all going to think, oh, she's just saying this because she's standing here and she has to be nice to us. Then she'll go to Germany and say the same thing. But, yes, I like to live here in Berlin a lot. Because you're all so good looking.
She was also sort of special because you didn't get that many Americans on British TV. So when you saw or you heard an American accent, you knew this must be someone quite special.
We love the wit, we love the kind of irony. And the fact that she would joke about anything, she would joke about the Holocaust being Jewish, that made, I think, the British love that. If you've got a great sense of humor, you can laugh at everything about yourself. Then you get a medal. So she worked here on and off, really, until the end of her life.
It's very hard for a woman to get older.
Yeah.
And older men, because I always faked orgasm, and now these old guys, you know, if you moan and groan in the wrong ear, they don't hear it. People in this room slept with John Kennedy. I'm just curious. I want to show of hands here. Now, what about the women? It is just. Oh, they turned the lights on like it's going to be real. I love.
She came over and made a series for British television. It was called Can We Talk? And with her background in, obviously, in American TV, she wanted to stick with a format. In American talk shows, they would have what I believe is known as the second banana. The second banana is another comedian who sits with the guests and kind of chips in and helps keep the conversation moving. And she desperately wanted Peter Cook to do this. They obviously knew each other. They presumably met in New York, where Peter Cook had spent quite a lot of time. But it was a very odd thing for him to do, to be second banana. And the series was a notorious disaster. Not because of her, but because for British audiences, there was Peter Cook sitting there not having to do anything.
We all do have these weaknesses, don't we?
Well, see, when it's silent, it's okay, because then you just walk fast and pretend, you know, it wasn't you. If you're in an elevator, blame the person next to you. Just go.
Yes.
Neil Shand, a colleague, and I were signed up. We've got Joan Rivers, and we're going to record 6 shows in 7 days. And we met and we had a chat. And like a lot of these people, this angry, hilarious extrovert was very quiet, well-spoken when you're talking to her and everything.
Yeah.
And Neil and I made some notes and notes of guests and what we'd write about the guests. Because it was going to be a real scramble, 6 shows in 7 days. And one of the first shows we had, Bernard Manning was booked, who she didn't know about. Rupert Everett, the actor, was on it. Peter Cook was there. But at the beginning of the show, Bernard Manning looked down the line at Peter Cook and said, "Saw you at the beginning of the show, Peter. Very funny." And he turned to the camera and went, so I thought, oh boy, what's going on? And then subsequently, Joan was aware there was an atmosphere going on, but she was loving it. He said about Rupert Everett, no, and him, he said, brains were dynamite, wouldn't blow his hat off. What was going on that night? Plus Joan Rivers, it was just amazing. And at the end of the recording, Rupert went for Manning physically and had to be held back. This was in front of the audience.
But did she like that kind of atmosphere?
Oh, she loved anarchy. Oh, yeah. Yes.
She was a good writer, Barry. What do you think?
Oh, yes, indeed.
She wrote books. She wrote her own scripts.
Yes, she was a brilliant writer, and she would do whole routines in her show.
I belong to Overeaters Anonymous. Once a month, they meet at my house and they cry. Oh, no one loves me. Is that so? Your butcher loves you. Your baker loves you. Is that so? I was on an airplane. They made me buy two seats. Yeah, but you got two meals. They broke up. It is just...
Joan Rivers wrote a lot of her own jokes, which is unusual for that era of comedians. She had some writers, but mainly she would write her own material, partly because a lot of her material was really about herself. You know, she would joke generally in a way that no one would dare present to a performer or to a celebrity.
With Joan, she liked being set up with the material, but she could go off in any direction. And if I happened to go off into a completely different area, she either could think of a joke or had a joke or had a sort of way of describing things that she could go with any area.
I'm sure you're fine.
Are you good in bed?
Hey, the night is a bit young, Joan. Well, no, I'm good. You know, I got the Winsiette pajamas.
I think I was lousy in bed. I stayed with my husband because I'm a widow now. I said, why don't you call out my name while we're having sex? He said, I don't want to wake you up. And now I'm going out with men that are so old, you know, it's just, during sex they call it their booper number. I mean, it's just... She married very well.
Yeah.
Doesn't that get you crazy? I mean, the girl, it's after midnight, girl slept around. Yeah. I mean, I once said to her, why do you sleep with anybody? She said to me, practice makes perfect. I mean, the girl just didn't stop.
Good old Heidi.
Married a rich guy, has foreign help. And, you know, and I understand that the wedding night, he said to her, would you take off your brassiere? And she said to him, that's extra. I mean, you know.
So as we all know from Larry Sanders, the ultimate ambition of comedians who appear on talk shows is they want to take over as host.
By 1986, Joan Rivers was apparently an essential part of the Johnny Carson show. But in 1986, Johnny Carson's contract got renewed for 2 years and her contract got renewed for 1 year. And she started to think, hey? And she found in her NBC office a list of people who they were lining up as possible replacements for Johnny Carson if he were to leave the show, fall ill. And her name was not on that list. And she realised that her time on the show was limited, that she was not essential, that she had to find some fresh way to make money. Just as she discovered that her options were limited on The Tonight Show, Fox approached her with the offer of doing her own late-night talk show up against Johnny Carson, really. It would be competing for some of the same guests. It would be going head-to-head with him.
It caused a huge rift between them. Carson felt that he was betrayed, that she'd actually set up as a kind of rival to him, and it more or less ended their friendship, which was a shame because they had obviously got on so well.
Joan Rivers' Fox show was not initially a success. There were teething problems. And the network Fox thought that the problem was Edgar Rosenberg, who was the producer, but also Joan Rivers' husband. So towards the end of the first 12 months, they decided to get rid of him. And Joan Rivers said, no, it's him and me. You know, it's both of us or neither of us. So they sacked both of them. And she was out in the wilderness. As the couples, Joan Rivers and her husband, were coming to terms with the fact that their show had been cancelled, perhaps for reasons of tension, she asked for a divorce. And 3 days later, he killed himself.
The guilt hit her like a truck. I mean, she was really devastated by this. They had a daughter, Melissa. She refused to talk to her mother for a really long time. In fact, Rivers has already said that she contemplated suicide herself. She said she was sitting in her house with the gun in her hand.
Tell me what happened.
It was just a very bad moment. My daughter wasn't talking to me. My career was gone at that moment and everything was wrong. And I actually took out a gun. And then I had this little dog, it sounds so, and he crawled into my lap. And I thought, somebody needs me.
It took an awful long time for her to come to terms with what had happened and her own feelings of guilt about her husband's death. The way she did it was through comedy, was through talking about it. And she did it in a very Joan Rivers-ish way.
Yeah, I think I'm lousy in bed. My husband never said so, but I think so. Once I said to him, well, I can't prove it anymore. How old are you?
She did jokes about that as if it was some sort of therapy. If you joke about a subject like your husband's suicide, I mean, the frisson in the audience, there was one or two nervous laughs, one or two groans, and a stunning silence, but on she went as if everything was still okay.
I find if you tell the truth, people will understand you on stage much better. When I finally came back after my husband killed himself, and I went on stage the first time, and it was a very big room in Las Vegas, and you knew that they knew what was wrong. So I just walked out and said, my husband killed himself. First joke. And it was my fault. We were making love, and I took the bag off my head.
Her daughter still wasn't speaking to her, so Joan Rivers took her out to a very expensive restaurant in order to have a rapprochement.
I took her out to dinner, and I could not reach her. I couldn't get to her. And we go to dinner in this very famous restaurant, very expensive in Beverly Hills, and we sit down, we open the menu, and I said, Melissa, if Daddy were alive and saw these prices, he'd kill himself all over again. And she laughed. My daughter back. So.
That was it. They then reunited and became mother and daughter again. It made her laugh.
My husband committed suicide. It was really very chic. It was in the 80s. It was something to do. Now Dad's like, oh, everybody's doing it. I'm gonna come, oh, please just email me. I mean, it's just so... my day working, half my day going to funerals. And the minister always says the same thing. She's in a better place. And you want to go, no, she's not. She had a house in the Hamptons. But,
well, bring your parents up, of course.
Hey, how are
hello,
you?
This is your father. How young he is. This is your dad. This is Deborah Messing's father, ladies and gentlemen. And here's your husband. How good to see you again. And your mother.
What a pleasure.
The thing about Joan Rivers was that she was completely fearless. Fearless in her own life, fearless in her comedy, but also feeling fearless in her dealings with other people. It's made her an absolute natural for interviewing on the red carpet at award ceremonies like the Oscars, because she would ask questions that no one else would dare to ask.
So she would stand on the red carpet as the stars came up. She would essentially ask, you know, who are you wearing tonight? But whereas a lot of interviewers would leave it at that, she would then make the sly, snide comment. So of Angelina Jolie, she once said, your leg's out, dear. Are you trying to get rid of a yeast infection? So she was always able to kind of, she wasn't part of the celebrity circus. She was always mocking the celebrity circus.
How you doing?
I'm thrilled to see you. Now, why are you matching?
It just worked out that way, you know? She got her dress about 2 days ago.
Did you know, you didn't plan this?
No.
No, not really, not. I knew.
Well, I worried that, you know, she's, it's all very well for an obscure person to make jokes about, you know, the rich and famous, but she was mixing with the rich and famous when she wasn't making jokes about them. I just wondered whether I want, you know, asked her, do people ever, you know, take against her or to might come up to her and complain about her? But she claimed that, other than Willie Nelson's daughter once told her to leave off him, that's the only time that she could think of.
She was a star as much as the people that she was interviewing. And I think that that sort of raised the game and raised the stakes for that kind of usually rather banal exchange that happened. And it suddenly became entertainment in itself.
Last night in Croydon, we had a blind woman. And I was talking to her, I had no idea. She had a dog next to me. I thought she had forgotten to shave her outside leg. I had no idea.
Towards the end of her life, in a way, she became more successful than at any other previous point. Perhaps she wasn't on NBC, but what she was, she had a huge impact, particularly with other celebrities, with fashion designers, with the world of luxury goods. She was an icon. She had already decided that there was nothing anyone could do to her that would hurt her anymore. Fire me, I've been fired. Have a husband commit suicide, I've committed suicide. I'm going to enjoy myself.
The other side of her, she had her shopping channel, where she'd be selling, she designed jewellery and then sold it on the shopping channel. It wasn't like a sideline, she was very, very devoted and dedicated to that. She was doing a stage show in the Haymarket Theatre, two performances each Sunday for three Sundays. And she had somebody else to start the show, and I think the somebody else was Graham Norton, but he couldn't do the middle Sunday. So she asked me to do it. So I said, oh, fine, yeah, I'll come on and do, I don't know how long I was supposed to do, 10 minutes, 20 minutes or something. We were agreeing to talk about it before the show on the Sunday. So she said, oh, Friday morning, I can speak to you on Friday morning. She said, oh, yeah, I'll be just flying in then. So where are you flying in from? So I'm flying in from America. So for the middle Sunday, yes, I'm doing the show on the first Sunday, then going back to America to do the shopping channel and then flying back out again. She certainly didn't want to not do the shopping channel because that was the main money earner.
Of course, the irony was that her obsession with plastic surgery and with her appearance and with looking fabulous led her to have operation after operation, and it was one of those operations that in the end proved fatal. There was a breathing tube being placed down her throat, and there were elements about the way the breathing tube went down which were wrong, so she developed an infection, and she left the operating theatre, but a little while later died.
She died prematurely because it was for a small operation she went in for, and something went wrong, and it was complicated. So she might have been somebody that would have kept going, because she was still doing Vegas well into her 70s.
She would never have stopped. She would have been in full cry all the way through. And was, right till the end.
She cruises Toys R Us.
I think what made Joan Rivers unique was that she had no filter whatsoever. She basically said things that most people were thinking and didn't dare say themselves. I don't think that her motive was to shock. I think she just wanted to tell the truth as she saw it. She has had enormous influence over the next generation of female comics. I think she is an absolute pioneer.
Barry Manilow knows if he was on hard drugs, he could inhale Peru.
The accidental genius, almost, of Joan Rivers is that she did something that almost no comedian manages to do, which is decade after decade, she changes what she's doing and she's a success at it. So her fan base spans the generations. There are people who remember her from doing, you know, Johnny Carson and the NBC show, people who remember her from her acerbic 80s, and then there's a whole generation of youngsters who came across her on E! Or doing the Fashion Police. She had, you know, teenagers to pensioners were in her fan base.
Avatar! Didn't you hate that movie? $18 to see blue people? Give me a buck, I'll show you my legs.
She was just determined to be as well, absolutely as rude as possible to everybody and about everybody. think she remains the best example of that type of comedy.
Who is this? Barbara Streisand. It's just...
She's a great inspiration for female comics. She's one of those relatively few female comedians who were part of the landscape as a role model in an era where there weren't very many, and there have been steadily more and more and more.
Three orgasms in 10 years is multiple. I've achieved it.
That's partly because of her, which is a mark of real influence, I think.
Thank you and good night. It was a pleasure talking to you.
Dust off the easel and choose your weapons. Oils, acrylics, or watercolours. Brand new Landscape Artist of the Year is back starting next Tuesday night at 8 on Sky Arts.